But, little known fact, we went to the same grad school. Not at the same time, but the same grad school. Although her major professor was Yang Zhao, who was not my major professor. So she's going to tell us about some of her research. I'll let you talk about it.
Thank you for being here tonight. Is that the
I, yeah, switch. Thank you.
My topic is convergence analysis and the reverse integration of particles from optimization. So the outline of the talk is as follows. First, I'm going to give an introduction about what is optimization, and then I will talk about particles from optimization, and then I will talk about the algorithm of the particles from optimization. After that, I will talk about almost sure convergence of particles of optimization, followed by the importance of initialization of particles. And there I will talk about three different sequences that are used to initialize particles. And I will show you some numerical results. So what is optimization? So optimization is one of the cornerstones of applied mathematics. It is an important area in mathematics, which is used in our everyday life. For example, managers at a firm are concerned with maximizing their profit and minimizing their costs. And researchers at a laboratory maybe want to take the maximum information about the drug with doing minimum work. Aerospace engineers want to design aircraft which maximize speed or minimize fuel consumption. Likewise, maximization or minimization is an important area and active area of research. So the thing is, optimization can be divided into deterministic optimization and stochastic optimization. The world is far from being deterministic. So stochastic optimization is important and active area of research in applied mathematics. So first let me show you an optimization problem. So here we have a function which needs to be maximized or minimized. For example, let's say minimization problem in the d-dimensional space. And we have the function. So here I say the function is continuous, but it doesn't need to be continuous. We have a function defined in the d-dimensional space to the real life. And it may have constraints. So, like equality constraints and inequality constraints. So here we are going to find the minimum value of the function. So, as I said, optimization can be defined as deterministic optimization or stochastic optimization. In deterministic optimization, we use perfect information about the function. For example, we need derivative or Hessian information about the function in order to find the search. For example, the well-known Newton's method defined by this formula needs derivative and Hessian information. And the disadvantages are it may converge to a stationary point instead of the maximum or minimum value, and we cannot guarantee the convergence if tangent line becomes parallel to the x-axis, and we have problems in higher dimensions, and if we pick our initial point far away from the optimal value, we cannot guarantee the convergence. So these are some disadvantages of this deterministic optimization method. In stochastic optimization, we don't need such information. So the advantages are they rely on partial evaluations rather than gradient and Hessian information. We define the search direction from the stochastic component. And easy to implement, and they can be coded quickly, and you can apply to broad class of instruction problems. For example, the well-known genetic algorithm and kernel optimization, particle swarm optimization, clarified algorithm are common stochastic optimization method. On Monday, I'm going to talk about particle swarm optimization. So the particle swarm optimization is a population-based method. What does I mean by population-based method is instead of having the one solution, here we have pool of solutions. So on Monday, we are going to pick the most it is a stochastic method, as I mentioned before, and it is developed by Ebert and Kennedy in 1995. So Kennedy is a social psychologist, so this method is inspired by the social behavior of birds or fish. So have you seen when birds are looking for food, they always fly together, right? So this method is inspired by that behavior of birds. So this method has four assumptions, so you can think about this as birds looking for food. So first assumption, each particle is searching for the optimum. This is like each bird is searching for food. Second one, each particle is moving, hence has a velocity. So each bird is flying, so they have velocity. Second one, each particle remembers the position it was in where it had the best result. So that means each bird remembers the best position it has so far. And fourth one, particles communicate. That means birds communicate. So each bird knows the position of the bird who is closest to the food because they communicate. So those are the four assumptions of this model. So here we have two equations. First one is the update equation for velocity, and the second one is the update equation for position. In first equation, here we have v denotes velocity, and we have p best and g best. Here p best means individual particles' personal best value, and g best denotes particles' global best position. As I said before, the particles communicate, so each bird knows the best position achieved by any bird in the soil. So that position is g best. So we have p best, we have g best. And we have omega, C1, and C2. Those are positive parameters, positive constants. And R1, theta 1, and R2, theta 1 are uniformly distributed random numbers between 0 and 1. Since we have random components in the velocity, we have stochasticity with the velocity equation. And in the position, we can, after we update particle's velocity, we can update particle's position. So this is the flowchart for algorithm. So first, what we do is first we initialize positions and velocities of the particles. For example, if I have two dimensional case, so this is my x-axis, this is my y. Let's say I have 0, 1. This is my search space. I put my, let's say, 10 particles. I put 10 particles randomly in the search space. Right? That is my first step. And then I assign random velocities for each of them. And then I evaluate the objective function value. So this is my search space, and my function is empty in this case. Right? So I, for each particle, I evaluate the function value. And then for each particle, I check, so that is my setup step, and then I check whether they are at the initial step, my personal best for each particle is same as initial position. For global best value among each particle, I pick the one which has the smallest objective function value. This is a minimization problem. And then, so I have p best value, I have g best value. And then, using, when I have that two values, I can update velocity, then I update velocity, I can update position. And then, at my second iteration, so my particles are in a different place, so they are like this. And then, for the second one, I have to calculate p best again. For that, I check particles' previous position and current position. Among them, check which position has the minimum objective function value and assign that position as the p-best value. If current position is less than previous value, we assign current position. If it is greater than, we keep the previous value. Similarly, we update global best position such that we check whether at the second iteration again we check which one has the minimum function value and we the one check whether the previous one is less than the current one, and if it is previous value, if the current position is less than previous one, we assign current position as global best value, otherwise we keep the same previous if that as the personal best value, this current position is greater if it the previous value as the personal best value. Similarly, we obtain global best position such that which first object choose the position which has the minimum structure value among all, and check whether that position is less than previous global best value. If it is so, we keep assign that as the global best. Otherwise, we just keep the previous value. So we update velocity and then we update position. So here we have to make sure when we update the position, the particles are in the search space. So such that if my particle move out of the space, I assign the lower bound for this particle. If it is greater than lower bound, I assign lower bound. If it is less than lower bound, I assign the lower limit. So then my particles are always in my search space. So that is the algorithm of particle swarm optimization. So why do we choose particle swarm optimization? Because it is found to perform better than other algorithms in terms of convergence rate, success rate, solution quality, computational efficiency, and quality of results. And as you see, this algorithm is simple, and as I said before, it was introduced in 1995, so relatively new method when compared to generic algorithms and other methods, so less research is focused on particle swarm optimization. So over the past 2 decades, researchers have focused on initialization of particles, and some have focused on parameter selection, some modification and hybridized versions such that they modify the velocity equation, or some others try to hybridize particle swarm optimization and generic algorithm, particle swarm optimization and quality algorithm by choice. And some has focused on applications of PSO method. So there are a lot of work on applications such that portfolio optimization, antenna design, lot of applications in engineering and finance. And less work is focused on convergence analysis of PSO method. Even though there are some work, they are imprecise because they have unrealistic assumptions. One assumption is some have assumed that it has only one particle in the swarm. So if there is one particle, particles personal best and global best are the same. So, but that is, I would say that is not realistic, because to define a swarm, we need to have more than one particle. So that is not realistic, and there's no work to compare the characteristics of the object we function, and no one has formed that this equilibrium point is the optimum point. There are work to show that this converges, but they don't show that this convergence is the optimum point. So here we are going to show convergence of particle swarm optimization based on characteristics of the objective function, and we show that this method converges to optimum value of the objective function. So as I said, this is a stochastic optimization method. So in order to talk about convergence, we have to talk about convergence in stochasticity, not just convergence. So here, there are some work focused on convergence, assuming that the random numbers are constant, but we keep changing the random numbers at each iteration, so they are not constant. So to talk about convergence, first we have to know the definition of almost sure convergence, because this is stochastic. So here I wrote the definition for almost sure convergence. So if I have the measure space, probability space, then almost true convergence is defined like this. When n goes to infinity, xn converges to s, almost surely if this probability is equal to 1. So this is the goal. We are going to show that particle's best position converges to optimum value with probability 1. So that is the goal of this problem. So here I assumed three assumptions about the function. First one understand this function is continuous and bounded. Why I have this assumption? Because if the function is not continuous, let's say my function is like this, then this is my minimum value, this is my optimum value, but there's no algorithm which can catch this point if you don't have prior information about this point. So to catch this, to avoid this type of problem, I assume my function is continuous. And I assume my search space is bounded, so then my function is bounded. And third, I assume there is a unique minimum point. That is my assumptions about the function. And I have assumption that in the velocity equation, the two random numbers are not equal to zero simultaneously. So if they are equal to zero simultaneously, we find another two random numbers. So if we have that conditions, we can say this algorithm converges almost surely to the optimal value as t goes to infinity. So I'm not going to show you the proof because it's very long, so let me show you an outline of the proof. So I take A star to be the minimizer of the objective function and take the different distance between the current position and minimum value as the coordinate et. So my goal is to show when t goes to infinity, f of t best t, that means function value converges to f of A star, that is minimum value of the function as t goes to infinity for each part. So that is my first step. So to show that, we pick t best t such that but we have shown that this value is equal to minimum of the function. So now the goal is to show that this is equal to f of this one. So we know that this, when I have that two conditions, I can set my velocity equation like that, and position equation, modify it with error, and put them in the metric system. So I have this system, and if I show that spectral radius of this matrix is, if the spectral radius of this matrix is less than 1, then my method converges. Right, so that is how I show the proof. So if you are interested, I can show the proof later, so that is the outline of the proof. So let me talk about initialization of particles. So some, as I said before, some people have worked on initialization of particles. So population-based of algorithms, initialization plays a major role. Because if the particles does not cover just phase efficiently, let's say they are distributed only in one area, if they are like this, then I won't be, if my minimum is here, then I won't be able to track the minimum. So my particle should be defined all over the search space. So if they does not cover the search space efficiently, they may not be able to locate the optimum value. So initially, Monte Carlo sequences are used to initialize the particles. So let's see the problem with Monte Carlo sequences. So this is pseudorandom sequences, which is called as Monte Carlo sequences. The problem is there are some regions where there is no point. So for example, here we cannot find any point there. So they are not evenly distributed. So because of this, people can introduce quasi Monte Carlo sequences. So another name for quasi Monte Carlo sequences is low discrepancy sequence or quasi Monte Carlo sequences. So that is a deterministic alternative to pseudorandom numbers, and they have correlation so that they are uniformly distributed. So the advantages are they are more evenly distributed, and because of that they provide faster convergence rate. So examples of random distributed sequences are random coupled sequence and Pauli sequence. For example, let me show you how the random coupled sequence looks like. So the base is 2, so you take the interval 0, 1. So this is your interval. You divide into 2, so we take 1/2 and divide this again to 2, so we have 1/4. Divide this to 3/4. Keep the midpoint here, 1/8. Take the midpoint here, 5/8. Take the midpoint here, 3/8. Likewise, you keep taking the midpoint so that it covers the search space. And the CD sequence is dense in the interval 0, 1. And then we have the Holden sequence, which is same as random coupled sequence. The difference is they use prime numbers as its base. So for random coupled sequence, the base is always 2. For Holden sequence, we use prime numbers as its base. So Holden sequence is base 3, is defined like this, and in 2 dimensions, we tuple them. For example, Holden sequence in 2 dimensional spaces, 1/3, 1/2, 1/3, 1/4, 2/3. Likewise, we combine them. So if we want Holden sequence for n dimensional space, we take the first n primes and construct the sequences for each prime and combine the tuples. So then we have Holden sequence. So the problem with Holden sequence again is when the prime numbers become, when n becomes larger and larger, they have poor 2D projections. For example, this is Holden sequence for dimension 13 and 14. So P is 41 and 43. So here we can see there are areas where you don't have any point in the region. So that is not evenly distributed. And another thing is, as we said, particles on optimization is stochastic method. So we need to have stochastic initialization. So here, quasi-random sequences are deterministic. So this is not a get to initialize the pathways. So because of that, people have scrambled the randomized sequence, which is called as randomized quasi-random sequence, which is a scrambled version of quasi-random sequences. So there are several scrambling methods, and Dr. Chi, Mastami, and Wano proposed a method to scramble the sequence, and they call that as optimal Halton sequence. So I got a chance to work with Dr. Chi during one of the summer, and I went, so she was at Florida A&M University, so I went there during the summer and learned her sequence, and we could initialize our particles using her sequence. So this is how she scrambled the sequence, so this is the output. So the first one shows optimal shows Halton sequence, and the second graph shows optimal Halton sequence. So there you can see the points are more evenly distributed in the search space rather than Halton sequence. So we use that sequence to initialize the particles. So and then for illustration purposes, I'm going to show you some two-dimensional problems. So here I initialize using optimal Halton sequence. And I showed my analysis for six two-dimensional problems, and we did high-dimensional problems as well. So if you look at this function, so it is a ball shape and it has a unique global minimum point at 0.0. So here this graph shows how my particles are evaluated. So at the red color dot shows you particles' initial position. So initially they are put in the search space randomly, and after 10 iterations they have become closer to the 0.0, which denotes light green, and blue represents particles' position at iteration 25, and green represents particles' position at final iteration. So you can see that particles have converged to the 0.0. So if we have close look at the 0.0, we can see how my particles are distributed in the along the 0.0. So these are results. So here M denotes number of particles and N denotes number of iterations. And at each particle number and iteration number, we have evaluated the optimum position, and we can see the optimal value is 0.0 and the value is 0 as well, so they have reached the optimal value. And the error is very small. So if you look at the convergence graph of the function, so this is the initial evaluation. So it started from 1.4 around 1.4 and it converges to 0 after like 20 iterations. So this is another function. So here we have a large hole at the center, so and many local minimum points. So many methods track their optimal point at the minimum points because of having many local minimum points. Here we can see, yes, M and N are same as before, number of particles and number of iterations. So at each time we can see that it has converged to optimum point at 0.0. And this function, it has no local minimum and it has only global minimum point at 0.0. And once again, M and N same as before, so we can see it has also converged to the optimal point and the error is very small. Here again, this has several local minimum points in the space and we have unique global minimum point at 5.5 and function value is -1. So if you look at the results, you can see it has converged to the optimum point. This is same as before, another function, unique minimum point, and function values has converged to the optimum point. So we can see that by numerical results, PSO method converges, and we have shown mathematically that it converges as well. high-dimensional problems. So this, I took these two functions and in the two different ranges, and you see in all these four cases, we saw that ESO method converges to the optimal point when t becomes larger and larger. So that is the end of the talk, so I think I finished everything.
You just set up every optima of a bounded area, like, or you set up more condition for this bounded area? Like,
it depends on the problem. I didn't set up the search space. Uh-huh. So like, if we have a perfect space, then that is good. Like, if it's 2D, if we have box shaped one, better. But if, like, it could be like this.
Okay, so actually my question is,
okay,
you do know other field outside the optima, or you design the whole, like a map, you design what's a map, what's the geography of the whole map look like, or you just know your position of the optima?
Oh, you mean in numerical examples?
Yeah,
like how I pick the search space?
Yeah, like how about just a random, like, 2D bounded area.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know all of the information of this area, or you just know the optima of this area? And
if I know the optimum, then there's no point of doing that, right? So
yep.
I might not have information about the optimum value.
Maybe if I can add, maybe another way to ask this question. So there was that example with lots and lots of local minima and maxima.
Uh-huh.
Would the method successfully converge to the global optimum? Does it simply ignore all the local optimum, or does it find, or does it sort of find them and discard them? Do you just not get any information at all?
Regarding local minimum points, can you say the question again?
Maybe it would help if you could go back a couple slides. So like this one. So the result of, if I understand your question correctly, so the result of the algorithm would be to identify the global minimum.
Mm-hmm.
And then does the algorithm simply ignore all of the local minimum?
The output don't give you local minimum values. They don't, like, since I have many particles, at least one of them goes to that point. Some may be stuck at the local points, but at least I can find one in the global.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't say that. So that would give you at least some information.
Yeah.
So some particles would get stuck at the local.
But how do you like determine which one is a global max, for example, the global optimum, for example, this one? Because if it's like evenly, all of the population are evenly, like, separated in this whole map, like It really depends on, I guess it really depends on the gradient of like how each of the individual goes to the optimum, right?
Here we don't use information about the gradient. So this is a stochastic method. So they just randomly, like I said before, I don't have any information about the gradient. I don't know the gradient. So if this is my search space, I just put them randomly here. I assign them random positions, and according to the velocity equation, they change their positions. Let's say here. Likewise, since the velocity has, if you look at the velocity equation, see my velocity equation, the velocity change occurs in particles further descending and global descending. So always they try to follow the one that is closest to the optimum value. So likewise they try in the search space following the one who is closest to the optimum point and they converge. I don't say that it might go to exact point, but there may be cases it closer to the line, not this point, but very close to the optimum point.
So the advantage of this algorithm is that you're actually using a global global parameter, right? Mm-hmm. When you see, when you ask the other particles, okay, what's your best record, right? So you're not just looking at local, so the sort of like your path, your velocity is not just determined on where you've been, but it's also determined on what the other particles have done as well.
Follow the best particle, follow the best position, and follow the
range. And you can tell because you, at every iteration, you plug everything into the function. So you can identify which one's the best by just doing function evaluations.
So if you reach a plateau, like, do you keep on going or do you stop?
You mean a flat surface?
Yeah.
So it keeps, like, I define such that I have certain number of iterations. So in the surface, it will keep moving, but in the set, it will keep moving. Because I cannot define this to be stopped when it achieved, like, if I define my stopping criteria. Here, I do this. Until a certain number of iterations. I cannot make a correct. For most of the algorithms, what we do is we set if my optimal value, this is my optimal value, if difference between this and let's say t position, if this is less than some maximum, then stop. But I cannot assign this criteria. Why? Because I don't know this value. So, this 2 until, let's say, 100, if I set my iterations to be 100, this will do 100 iterations. Another setup is I can do this, I cannot do this because I don't know this. Another stopping criteria would be if my difference between new position and previous position, if they are closer to stop, if I have this, this doesn't work because in this case, this will trap at the local minimum points. So I set up n number of iterations as my stopping criteria.
Yes, there are several different stopping criteria.
Mm-hmm.
The top one is hard to reach because you don't know what is optimal position.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is quite really used because this is more close to the optimization. You position the previous one, the next one very close. And the another one is determined, you know, how many iterations you want to have. So give the iteration number. Say 1,100, at that time that's all.
Yeah. That's what we do.
What's the optimum number of iterations? How do you select that number?
Just randomly.
Randomly and
yeah,
keep
yeah,
trying
yeah.
to
I have a question. Anybody have students? You know, there is another optimization method used. We are not depends on gradient.
Mm-hmm.
So not use the Hessian matrix gradient, but use the cosine Newton method.
Okay.
So cosine Newton method, we avoid this difficulty to get gradient, but still we can do that, but I'm not sure. This works for their problem a lot. So my question is, for this certain objective function, your method works. Is there any limitation for the different the objective function?
Yes, I see.
So you have a lot of the you have a lot of the objective function for that. Yeah, looks quite well.
Yeah, the case is theoretically if we have, as I said, if I have a minimum like that, it may not be able to catch. But in here, it will catch the minimum as here. So, but the exact minimum is here.
Yeah, I know this is a very difficult thing. You catch a local and then you miss the global sometimes.
Yeah.
So Cutter method and simplex method is designed by using this way. They just find the step size, such as that if we have over that and then come back. There are many the new methods for that. Yeah. And my another question is, you give the position, maximum position, that means give the boundary. You know, the maximum yeah for this one. And then you will find if the initial condition has been changed. For example, it's just in the one part of your region is not uniformly distributed in this region, maybe have a difficulty. So I think is that possible? We can make the maximum and the minimum in terms of the time t. So in other words, your whole position is moved. Like your birds is moving, so it's a move, follow that. So is that possible? I think it's very difficult. Yeah.
One of them might like go, maybe.
Yeah, just move that. So this means to make the alpha maximum, alpha minimum is also depends on time. You know, this means we add one more parameter to the boundary, so such that they can move or something.
Oh, instead of moving to the boundary?
Yeah, to the boundary. So if they're closer to that, we do that. And another, can we just do the partition?
Yeah,
if you fix the
partition.
We do the partition,
yeah.
We do partition for that.
But that will not be stochastic again.
Yeah, I know. And the third is very interesting for the sequence. It's called the whole tension. Sequence, very interesting. And why they pick up the 2 and 3? The reason is there is a conjecture called the 2-3 conjecture. Because this is, this is still not proved yet, but every people think about this, correct. So that's the reason they pick up a 2 and 3 constructing that. So I was wondering, if I use the binomials system, ternary system, is there any the property of these kind of you understand what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I think decimal. It can be, but I don't know how to, but I think people have done in the literature. I think there are some for the time for binary.
There are like a few constants and things that well in principle in abstract the person that designs the algorithm decides, right?
What is it?
So you define some of the constants. So for instance, if you show
velocity equation,
that contains a bunch of constants and parameters, right? Then in principle, if you know nothing about the problem, you decide. I imagine that I actually applied applications. You get those constants from like observations in the market or the system or whatever.
Yes, some do analysis for how to pick omega C1 and C2 such that this converges.
Okay.
You could do analysis to find omega C1 6. In original method, omega C1 and C2 are not used. In literature, normally use omega to be point like when doing numerical calculations, use omega as 0.73. And see, that's C2, that's 1.4994.
Okay.
How stable is it? How stable is your algorithm with respect to the constant?
When I do the analysis, I take omega to be less than 1, and I took C1 and C2 to be constants. So my analysis, it doesn't depend on C1, C2.
How do you choose omega C1, C2? Is it from the experience or from the...
In literature, people do analysis, find omega C1 and C2 such that this method converges. So from that, we have normally omega 0.73, C1 is 1.49, and C2 is 1.49.
So give the region for that, such that it converges.
But for this analysis, I use the sign values for omega C1, C2, and just take them as constants. And omega is assumed to be the constant less than 1.
Is there a practice of like trying to optimize omega C1 and C2, sort of like apply the algorithm again up to the parameter space of omega C1 and C2 in order to like optimize convergence time, for instance?
Not convergence time, optimize like. So always we take t goes to infinity, so not depend on time, so how to find omega C and C2 such that this converges.
Okay.
Yeah. What kind of omega C1 C2 is it? It works. Your algorithm convergence. What is the range of omega C1 C2?
Omega
between
0 and 1.
That's definitely guaranteed works.
Yeah.
But how about more than 1? That's
more than 1, I don't know.
There are some counterexample also.
Maybe fly faster in the search space and maybe ignore the optimal point when omega is large.
The velocity is too large.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe the move is so fast, you cannot control that.
So I'm thinking of the bird, autoling the bird block. So for this to work, each bird would have to know the global best of each. Does that match with like the actual biological situation? Like do all the birds, maybe this is a biology question. Do all the birds know at each step who's doing the best?
So we assume they are honest and they communicate with each other?
Yeah.
I told them there's a very little food. That's what we do there.
Yes, true.
Any other questions? Well, we should say thank you again.
I believe there is a balance between that. Coefficient C1, C2 is for the position. Coefficient of the velocity is W, omega. So they have some relation from the I think probably that.